What's going on, everyone? This is Vince from Life with Vince Luu, and today I'm gonna take you through my pull-up workout. I'm just gonna do 150 pull-ups, 12 sets of 12 with a last set of six. But I'm gonna be talking to you all in between sets. So I'll just be dumping some advice, some tips, some tricks, things that just come to my mind. So the very first thing, if I could pick one piece of equipment to have in my house, it would definitely be a pull-up bar. With a pull-up bar, you can do a lot of things with it, but it's just overall really good. You could do pull-ups, chin-ups, and pull-ups and chin-ups, in my opinion, are one of the best exercises that you can do. You can do leg raises, you can do ab work, and pull-up bar. That's what I would recommend. All right, set number one. And then anytime I do pull-ups as well, I have to make sure to count them. I mean, obviously count them, but put them, like write them down. Cause I used to not do that, and then I'd be like three, four, five, and then by the time I get to like six or seven, I'm like, am I on six? I'm on seven. I'm on seven, I'm on eight. So you gotta make sure to write them down. And then if you notice also, when I do pull-ups, actually anytime I'm doing anything with biceps or I'm doing a pulling motion, I like to hook grip. I feel like with the hook grip, with the thumb out like that, I get more of my lats. So just an easy way to get more of your lats. If you grip it like the normal grip, you'll put some more pressure on your, what are these called? Your forearms. So anytime you're curling, you know, you could compensate by twisting your wrists in, and it's a little bit more forearms, but for me to hit my back, I really like the hook grip, or just really anytime I'm doing a pull motion, either a vertical pull or a horizontal pull, I like the hook grip. But I mean, on that one, I kind of did the regular grip and then did a hook grip, kind of like switch it up. Cause you know, it's also good to work your forearms as well. So gotta make sure to write that down. So two. And yeah, I think pull-ups is just my favorite exercise cause you can literally target a lot of things at once. And also it's super impressive when someone's able to do a lot of pull-ups. I mean, yeah, it's cool to squat a lot and deadlift a lot, but have you ever seen a guy at the gym just at the pull-up bar for an hour? Yeah, that's me. So I try to be that guy, and I'm just doing sets of 10. And it's not anything too crazy. It's like a minute and a half rest. And really, I just go whenever I feel like it. And that's my personal preference as well. When I work out, it's more of the feeling of however much rest that I need, especially when I'm doing pull-ups. When I'm doing strength workouts, it's a little bit different. I might definitely wait the 3 to 5 minutes. So, all right, set three. Also, music brought to you by Matthew Parker. So he's playing in the background. So I enjoy Matthew Parker. If you don't know who he is, you should definitely check him out. He's awesome. So with the pull-ups as well, or like the sets, I usually do sets of 10 to 12. Once I completed my 10 sets of 10, or now I do like 20 sets of 10 or 30 sets of 10, I've upped the per set to 12. So that's what I personally like. And with that being said, you always hear people say, oh, like the rep ranges, you know? So what are those rep ranges? So hypertrophy or muscle building is an 8 to 12 rep range with a 60 to 90 second in between rest, whereas a strength is the, you know, 1 to 5 rep range with a 3 to 5 minute rest. So depending on what your goal is, you're going to be doing those certain rep ranges. So with hypertrophy, this is how I think about it, is that your muscle, so here's your muscle, and when you do a set, let's say 12, you're ripping the muscle, and then you're waiting 60 to 90 seconds, and the muscle is recovering, but before it's fully recovered, 60 to 90 seconds, you're ripping it again, and then it's that motion over and over and over, and that's why with hypertrophy or muscle building, your muscles get bigger. Whereas strength, you're looking more of a 3 to 5 rep range, because you're exerting all that energy. Say like I was doing a deadlift motion, and you're ripping the muscle, boom. But for it to fully recover, it takes 3 to 5 minutes, and then once the muscle's fully recovered, then you're gonna do another set. So depending on why, or depending on your, like if you're bulking, if you're cutting, if you wanna get bigger, if you wanna get stronger, will depend on if you're doing hypertrophy sets or strength sets. So, all right, next set. Four. And with that being said, that's why if you look at me, I am super small. I'm about 134 pounds right now. And that's because for the past 5 or 6 years, I never really did hypertrophy. I mean, yeah, I did 8 to 12 rep range, but I was really focused on strength. So I feel like I'm pretty strong for my size. I could deadlift at 134 pounds. I could deadlift 415 without a belt, 425 with a belt. I can dumbbell press the hundreds, right? That's flat bench. I haven't bench pressed in a long time. Or I don't really bench press a lot nowadays just because it's scary without a spot. And, you know, with a bench press, if you don't have a spot and it's a barbell, you're dead. There's no way. But with a deadlift and with a squat, you can definitely do. And then I haven't trained my squat in a while, but when I was serious about it, I was squatting 315. So 315 is the most I've ever done. 325 is the most I've ever done. And I never went past 325. And that was around the same weight as well, about 134. But nowadays, all I care about are my pull-ups and my deadlifts. So you have to make sure you are conscious of your workout routine. And when they say the rep ranges as well, when I say like when I'm doing 3 sets of 3 for strength, it's literally if I did the 4th set, I wouldn't be able to do it. If someone put a gun to my head, I wouldn't be able to do it. And same thing with your hypertrophy. It's an 8 to 12 rep range. So you're doing sets of 12, but in actuality, like what really you should be like, you're doing sets of 12, but the weight should be so heavy that if you try to go for that 13th one, you're not able to do it. And that's what people get confused, is that they're like, oh, I did 4 sets of 10. It's like, yeah, but you really could have done 30 with that weight. So make sure you're conscious of that. All right, next set. All right, 5. That's 5. I think. See? I don't. Forgot already. That's 5, yeah. Anyways, that's why I'm super small, but I'm super strong for my size, because that's literally just what I've been doing. And the other part of it is with fitness, I mean, most people, I would say most people that I meet, or the clients that I did have when I was a trainer, 8 out of 10 are looking to lose weight. With losing weight, that's just a whole different ball game than like getting bigger or getting stronger. I mean, a lot of it, there's a lot of overlap, but with losing weight especially, it's more about your diet more than anything. Actually, I mean, out of all of them, like hypertrophy, strength, all that, it's a lot of it is diet as well, but especially fat loss or weight loss. All right, I'm gonna do another set. Be right back. Woo! All right, 6. And with that, with your diet, people always ask, like, or, you know, they're always asking me, okay, how do I lose weight? How do I lose weight? Do I need to be doing sit-ups? Do I need to be doing crunches? And the first thing that you need to know, or not the first thing, but something that just comes to mind right now, is that there's no such thing as spot reduction. So if you want to have a six-pack, you can't lose, I mean, you won't lose fat by doing a bunch of sit-ups or crunches. That's not gonna help. With that being said though, how you get your abs to show is that once you lose weight overall, your body, based off of your genetics, will pull fat from wherever it's gonna pull. So some people store the fat here. A lot of, I do. Actually, no, I don't. I store the back, yeah, more of like on my front. So my abs are like really kind of like the last show, my back will show first. But it's solely based off of genetics. And if you lose enough weight, you'll get your abs to show. So no such thing as spot reduction. So remember that. The battery's on 2 bars. Hopefully it doesn't die. All right, that's 7. Okay. So no such thing as spot reduction. So if you're doing crunches, doing abs because you want to lose belly fat, there are way better exercises that you can do. So with that being said, you want to do exercises that are going to burn a lot of calories. So that you can burn the fat, because the more calories that you burn, the more energy that you're expending, and that will make you in turn lose the fat. My mind's kind of like all over the place right now. So what happened, and you know, when I first started fitness, I didn't understand this concept of, because you always hear people say, oh, just burn more than you consume, or it's intake versus outtake. But what does that really mean? So what happens is that everyone has their maintenance calories. And let's say, for example, for me, it's 2,500 calories. So if I eat 2,500 calories, it doesn't matter if it's proteins, carbs, fats, 2,500 is my maintenance. So if I eat 2,501, I'm going to be gaining weight. If I eat 2,499, I'm going to be losing weight, theoretically, right? So imagine this 2,500 number. But with that, a calorie on average, and it's a little bit different for everyone, but this is like the general consensus, is that a calorie is about 3,500 calories. So if you want to lose 1 pound, not a calorie, I'm sorry, a pound is equal to 3,500 calories. So if you want to lose 1 pound, you have to burn 3,500 calories. Usually it's not within a day, because think about it, I weigh 2,500, my maintenance is 2,500. If I want to lose weight, I can't, like, it's not, you're not going to lose, even if you don't eat for one day, you're going to lose, I'm going to lose less than a pound. So you have to spread that out over a week. So 3,500 divided by 7, which is 500 calories per day. So if my maintenance is 2,500 and then I eat 2,000 calories per day for a week, in that week I will lose 1 pound. And that's how you calculate your like rate of losing weight. So if I double that, so that's 500, negative 500 calories is for 1 pound. If I do negative 1,000, that's gonna be 2 pounds. And so on and so forth. And then you can lose 1.5 pounds, 2 pounds, 2.5 pounds. But also it's not healthy to lose weight, all that weight super fast. And you shouldn't really lose more than 1% of your overall body weight. So for me, if I weigh 134, I should not lose more than 1.3 pounds per week. That's on the high end for me personally. And you might be different. If you weigh 250 pounds, you can, you know, lose up to 2.5 pounds per week. So, all right, next set. Come on, let's do it. That's 8. Okay, and then going back to the whole nutrition discussion is that, so my maintenance calories, let's say mine is 2,500. If I eat 3,000 for that day or for the week, for a week, that's 500 more, I'm gonna gain 1 pound. And this is what happens is that when you eat more than your maintenance, your body converts that extra calories into weight, into fat. So that's what they mean about you have to burn more than you consume. So when you're burning 2,500 calories, but you're only consuming 2,000 calories, your body is burning that 2,000 calories, or the body is burning 2,000 calories of the food that you ate, because that's how much you consumed for the day, but that 500 calories extra that your body's burning is from the fat that is stored on you. And that's how you get fat loss. But you have to do it for over a long enough period of time to where you're gonna be losing it safely, right? So, all right, another set. All right, woo! Talking a lot. All right, it's 9. So I have 3-4 more sets. Yeah. So if you wanna lose weight, what I would recommend personally is to download MyFitnessPal. And with MyFitnessPal, you can put in all the food, you can scan the food, the very best thing. But there are pros and cons to tracking your food. I'm a big believer in tracking your food because you know exactly what's going in. And if you have a Fitbit or some type of smartwatch, you know exactly how much is going out. So you know how many calories that you burn per day. So you can manipulate the factors and just have more data to work with. So if I know that, especially right now, I'm running 10 miles a day for 30 days, I'm burning so many more calories than I would normally burn. But based off my Fitbit, per day I burn about 3,400 calories, or 33 to 34. So I make sure to have to eat that much because I don't want to lose weight right now. Because I just like don't think about it and just eat whatever, I might not get enough calories and I'll be sore the next day and I won't have energy for the next day. So MyFitnessPal and a Fitbit are gonna do, or not a Fitbit, it's just an Apple Watch, anything to track your calories. So, all right, next set. All right, 10, that's 10. 120 down. 30 more. I had another point about the whole MyFitness. Oh yeah, so tracking, you know exactly what's going in, not exactly what's going out. But what a lot of people don't talk about are the negatives of it. And one of the big negatives is that you may, I did, and it took me a long time to get out of this mindset, but you may develop a bad relationship with food. Because once you understand calories and macros, and all this and all that, you're like, I don't want to eat that. And it's food that you used to like, you used to love. But once you realize how many calories it is, how many calories that it takes to burn this, and I run a mile and it burns about 100 calories, but a Whopper, you know, like those chocolate Whoppers, one Whopper has 10 or 11 calories. So if you eat one Whopper, you have to jog for a minute. Is that worth it? I don't know, maybe. To me it is now, but before I'd be like, oh no, I would never eat that. So just be careful of that. You know, if you decide to track, that you may develop a bad relationship with food. But there is a middle ground, and I'll talk about that middle ground after this set. Hello, I'm filming right now. What?
Use the cat sponge for our dishes.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know which one is the cat sponge and which one's ours.
Sorry. Okay, I'll be in a little bit. Okay, I accidentally used the cat sponge because we have a different sponge for our dishes. We have our sponge and a cat sponge. But they're both the same color, so how am I supposed to know? That's what I get for doing the dishes. Okay, anyways, I'm sorry. Back to the point. I can't think right now. Yeah, I better write that down. That's 11, right? I don't think I did that yet. Okay, 11. Two more sets. One more set of 12, one more set of 6. So, the middle ground is intuitive eating. With intuitive eating, you're just consciously making better decisions. So you're not tracking everything, it's not a headache, you're not stressed out, but you're consciously making better decisions. So if you wanna lose weight, that is, right? So if you're drinking soda, drink diet soda. If you're, not that I, you know, advocate for diet soda, I personally like diet soda, and I haven't drank in a real soda in a long, long time. I choose not to. When I have diet soda, I'll drink diet soda instead of regular. But that's a whole nother story of like how healthy it is, how bad for it is you. And right now I'm purely speaking about losing weight from a calorie ingestion point of view. So with intuitive eating, you just make better decisions. Instead of, for steak, if you eat ribeye, you can eat New York strip. Yeah, it's not as good, it's not as fatty, but it's way less calories than a ribeye. Or if you're eating sauces, no sour cream. No guacamole. Guacamole and avocados in general just have higher calorie content. They're good fats, but coming from a perspective of, again, calorie number of calories and just ingestion in general. So intuitive eating, I think that's personally what I would recommend to most people, unless you're good with numbers or that you like exactly every little detail. That's how I am. I like exactly every little detail as far as my calorie consumption. So intuitive eating would do really well and just overall make better decisions. Like, don't eat pork. Pork tends to be a little bit fattier. Eat more seafood, eat more fish. When you're making rice, brown rice instead of regular rice, right? It has more fiber, it'll keep you fuller for longer. More vegetables. So intuitively eating, so using your intuition. So just making better choices overall. All right, so my battery died, but I finished that last set of 12 and I did an additional set of 6. So hope you all enjoyed that. Let me know what you think in the comments below. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, let me know down below. If you haven't already subscribed, make sure you subscribe to my channel. Give this video a thumbs up. If you like it, it really helped me out. Other than that, see y'all soon.